Now we're going to continue our exploration of the New England flora, and this time we're going to focus on the non-native and invasive plants that grow in New England. Recall that about 39% of our flora actually didn't originate here. They were brought in or they've spread by themselves into New England but are not actually regarded as native here. But not all non-native plants are what we would call invasive. About 109 species, which is only about 3% of our flora, is a cause of worry. What do we mean by invasive? Well, a formal definition might be non-native plants, or indeed animals, that can adversely affect the habitats they spread within, either ecologically or environmentally or economically, sometimes all three. Our poster child for a very damaging invasive plant, one that can quite literally and physically take over a habitat, is kudzu, shown here, Pueraria lobata. Prevalent in the South, where it was planted widely for wildlife, it has taken over whole habitats by throwing a carpet of itself over native plants. It's slowly making its way into New England, so botanists are keeping a real close eye on its spread. Some of our invasive plants have been introduced for good reason, either for the fact that they can grow quickly and provide ecosystem services such as controlling erosion or providing succulent fruits for birds and mammals to consume, or even blocking headlights in oncoming lanes from each other, or quite simply that they're lovely to look at as you pass them by on the highway or in gardens. A particularly aesthetically pleasing plant is Oriental bittersweet, Celastris orbiculatus, whose showy, red, long-lasting fruits make for beautiful wreaths in the fall and winter. But birds actually feed on those fruits and disperse them widely to places well away from your front door, where the aggressive vines of Oriental bittersweet begin to climb on other vegetation, much as the dreaded kudzu does. Drive down a highway or walk down a hiking trail, and you may see a number of unfortunate trees overtaken by the heavy curtains of these plants. If invasive plants don't physically grow on other plants, some invasives can simply crowd other plants out. Common reed, Phragmites australis, is a 14-foot tall grass, which is now dominating a large area of freshwater and brackish marshes by virtue of its ability to spread by thick rhizomes and its ability to shade out other species. If you've driven by the meadowlands in New Jersey and New York recently, you may see that this is the primary species that rules over these wetlands, excluding most others. As we've learned, plants depend a lot on their soil chemistry in order to thrive. Some invasive plants can actually change the chemistry of the soil, altering the composition of microbes that inhabit it and that provide nutrients to native plants. One such invasive is garlic mustard, Aliaria petiolata. It establishes relationships with microbes that favor its growth at the expense of the microbes that nourish other plants. Other species, such as Japanese barberry, Berberis thunbergii, seem to attract other harmful organisms, such as non-native earthworms, that can impede the growth of native forest plants. These earthworms greatly speed up the decomposition of leaf litter and hasten the natural cycling of nutrients, such as nitrogen, in the soil. This changes both the texture and the nutrient-giving nature of the soil for the native flora. Many plants depend on insect pollinators, such as bees and wasps and flies, to complete their reproduction. When an invasive plant becomes dominant in an area, especially one with showy flowers, such as purple loosestrife here, Lithrum salicaria, it can lure pollinators away from the native plants they would have ordinarily visited. This deprives native plants of the opportunity to produce their seeds while giving invasive plants the leg up on reproduction. Sometimes, pollinators will pass pollen from invasive species to a related native species, causing them to hybridize. Now, invasive plants are not some super mutated monster plants. They have moved into a new area and are simply taking advantage of the same conditions that all plants like. disturbance, particularly new construction, road building, or other land conversion, opens up new habitat that they can colonize. And if the soils are particularly fertile, rich in nitrogen or phosphorus or calcium, any self-respecting plant would readily move in there. And if an exotic plant has been able to escape the species that normally would have eaten it in its native range, such as insects or mammals, so much the better. It can simply set up house and thrive. So it's important to understand that the plants we call invasive now may actually eventually assimilate themselves into our flora over the course of decades. Invasive plants can flourish and even explode in certain areas, much to our alarm. But given time, they may become better behaved members of the flora once our herbivores become aware of them and challenge them, or we learn to eat them. There are some great recipes out there for Japanese knotweed, incidentally. In the meantime, though, they do pose a threat to our native habitats, and conservation professionals who are concerned about the rare species that invasives may crowd out are worried. We'll talk more about rare plant species later on. Is it hopeless? Are invasive plant species going to take over the world? No. There are several steps that you can take to minimize the impacts of invasive species in your garden or your town. Learn, first of all, how to recognize them. There are a lot of resources, including some handouts that follow this lesson, that will help you learn how to spot them. Next, report them. There's an app for that. EdMaps is a national early detection and distribution mapping system based at the University of Georgia, and it has more than 2.7 million records of invasive species sightings made by citizen scientists throughout the country. You can sign up to learn how to identify and report the location of invasive plants. And early detection is really crucial to removing invasive species, such as kudzu, before they gain a major foothold in the region. Finally, don't plant invasive species. Some garden centers advertise them widely because they're easy to grow. But before you know it, these may take over your garden, your neighbor's yard, and the forest or field next door. Some particularly invasive species have been banned for sale. You can learn whether a particular plant is banned by visiting its information page on GoBotany or looking at lists of invasive plants on your home state's website. I've provided a handout that gives you lots of these websites to look at. Sometimes, even exotic plant species that look harmless today can evolve invasive tendencies later. So it's best to be on the safe side and choose to plant native species wherever you can. As this photo of Garden in the Woods in the spring shows, native plants are just as easy to grow and make great choices for both naturalistic and formal garden settings. P.S. You can learn more about designing with native plants by taking our third course in this series, Designing with Natives. So what if you have an invasive plant growing in your yard or a nearby park or other area where you live? It's practical to hand pull small infestations that only cover a few hundred square feet. You might have to do this a couple of years in a row, so don't be discouraged. Be persistent. For larger infestations, it's best to coordinate removal efforts with your local conservation organization, say the Park Authority or Conservation Commission or Land Trust, because they have the experts on hand who know how best to treat invasive species. We don't recommend that you as a homeowner use chemicals such as Roundup, as you may inadvertently kill native plants. Trust the experts who are licensed to apply herbicides to come up with the best strategy. Know that it's not enough to simply remove a whole bunch of invasives and then pat yourself on the back and walk away. If you or an organization does remove invasive species, be prepared to revisit the site regularly to make sure that this invasive species is not making a comeback or that other invasives are not moving in. Caring for the land is a long-term commitment, but it's worth it for sustaining healthy habitats and for fostering your own appreciation for where you live. Next, check out our resources on invasive plants.